Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have discussion for the day 20th of August 2018. Today we are going to see 5 topics in our discussion. Today's first topic is reality check on simultaneous polls. Recently, Chief Election Commissioner O.P. Rawat said it is not possible to hold simultaneous elections for the Lok Sabha and State Legislative Assembly. What is simultaneous elections? It means that conducting elections at the same time for Lok Sabha and State Legislative Assembly. It is not possible, he says. Why? It is an ambitious target. It is a heavy burden task for the Election Commission. It has its own limitations. Because simultaneous elections would demand a massive increase in the number of electronic voting machines as well as VVPAT, which is voter verifiable paper audit trail. To be precise, simultaneous elections would require 24 lakh electronic voting machines. That means we have electronic voting machines now. With existing number of electronic voting machines, we cannot hold simultaneous elections. That means we need more number of electronic voting machines. And we need equal number of VVPATs unit also. Ensuring availability of VVPATs everywhere, that is across the country, is not possible. Means it is very tough. Why? It has its logistical challenge. And altering the term of assembly needs an amendment of the constitution. Amending the constitution is not an easy task. We need to bring political consensus across the country between various political parties. Parties with different ideologies have to come together to support this idea called simultaneous polls. Otherwise, this would not be possible. Parties that control legislature constituted in recent months may not support this idea. For example, a party that came to power 4 months back will not be happy to go for elections again, and they will not be happy to dissolve their state legislative assembly. This is one thing. And another thing is that the parties who support this concept says that if simultaneous elections have been conducted, we can concentrate on governance. That is, adequate focus can be given on governance rather than going on election mode. Secondly, they say that simultaneous elections can bring down the expenditure to a considerable level. Legislature terms can be curtailed only through an amendment. This has to be done without undermining representative democracy and federalism. So, what this article says that instead of concentrating on simultaneous polls, which is very difficult to conduct as per Chief Election Commissioner O.P. Rawat, it is better political parties can focus on basic electoral reforms and find ways to curb excessive election expenditure on themselves. Today's second topic is for better slum policies. India is witnessing rapid urbanization. People from rural areas moving towards urban centers in search of employment, in search of educational opportunities. For thousands who come to cities every day, they find cheap housing in slums is often a springboard for better lives. This means that people who come from rural areas find cheap housing as an opportunity. They can stay there and in search of employment, they can stay there and study. So that after their studies, after they get proper employment, they can move towards other area. They believe in such a way that in reality, this is not happening. These migrants often get stuck in vicious cycle of debt and socio-economic stagnation. How they fall into the debt trap? Let's see little later. To frame any policy, we need proper data. When it comes to slums, we do not have concrete figures on slum and number of people who are living there. So this is a one deterrent factor. We do not know really how many temporary and semi-permanent settlements are present. Slums have a fluid definition, which means that we do not have a comprehensive definition for slums. It excludes the people. This led to the exclusion of people, and we follow legal pedanticism. What it means? We follow the legal rules and regulations in literal manner instead of concentrating on reality. So this fluid definition and bookish approach lead to exclusion error. The 2011 census estimated that 65 million people are living in slums. This is very less compared to UN Habitat's 2014 estimation of 104 million people are living in slums. So there is a gap, there is an exclusion. This exclusion error has to be reduced. People living in slums facing socio-economic distress. Why? Because current slum policies primarily focus on housing, relocation, in-situ development alone. They do not concentrate on socio-economic distress faced by the people and what are the solutions can be given. Over 70% of families that live in slums are trapped by debt. How? the difference between their monthly earnings and their monthly expenses is very less, that is 1000 rupees. For example, if a person is earning 10,000, his monthly expenditure is 9,000. That means he is left with only 1000. In case of medical emergency, in case of educational emergency, he is left with only 1000. So he needs to go to moneylender and get money. He has to pay heavy interest, and he do not get a formal loan facilities. With no access to formal financial systems, any borrowing comes from private money lenders at a high interest rate, which is a cause of concern, which is a burdensome for those people living in slum areas. Even the basic amenities like water and electricity are disproportionately more expensive in the slum areas. They rely on the grey market rather than formal subsidized channels. The cumulative effect, the overall effect of all these problems is the residents who consider slum areas as temporary one end up in staying in the same slums for an average of 21 years. There are 7 out of 10 households stayed in slums for at least 4 generations, which is a cause of concern. These families earned only marginally more than newer migrants. Even when families move out of the slums, they are moving towards cheaper and worst off slums, which is very worst thing. Even after facing lot of hurdles, lot of challenges, youngsters in those regions are studying and getting their education. Even after their better education levels, they are struggling to get jobs. It is because due to the rapidly changing profile of entry level jobs. With undergraduate or technical certificates, they can only get low paying jobs. Much like their parents, the youth earn very less than compared to more educated peers who don't live in slums. We need slum policy, but that slum policy should not be same for the entire nation, because one size fits all approach will not be suitable to India. Because in many established slums, because of the political patronage, they have produced concrete houses, title deeds, piped water and regularized electricity. Here the economic opportunities and employment are the key. On the other hand, there are slums who are really struggling. That slums resembling a tented refugee camps. They need just housing and basic amenities as of now. Until these nuances are considered, whatever measures we are taking will not yield the results. Today's third topic is sovereignty and sensitivity on India-Bhutan relations. Recently, Border Roads Organization, which helps to build Bhutanese roads under Project Dandak, decided to make those markers in shades of Indian tricolor. This means that when India undertaking some developmental projects in Bhutan, we keep our markers, that is Indian flag there. But Bhutanese youngsters are not happy with the way Border Road Organization have behaved. They have expressed their displeasure on social media. Of course, we are helping Bhutan. That doesn't mean that we have to put our shades of Indian tricolor on those projects. In a short span of time, Himalayan Kingdom, which is Bhutan, is going to face this third general election in 10 years. The People's Democratic Party, led by Togbe, enters the election with a visible edge, that is, he is likely to win. He can take credit for stabilizing rupee guldram crisis that had happened when he enters the office, as well as he brought economic reforms also. But at the same time, he could not curb the national debt owned mostly to India for hydropower loans. And he was criticized by opposition parties for taking pro-India stance. This election comes after 73-day India-China standoff at the Doklam. All the opposition parties in Bhutan advocating that Bhutan foreign policy have to be framed in such a way that it is less dependent on India. That is, Bhutan people and Bhutan political parties want India not to behave like a big brother. Considering this scenario, India must step lightly and thoughtfully around the upcoming election. Mr. Manmohan Singh led UPA government decided to cut cooking gas subsidy just before 2013 election in Bhutan. It had been seen that India is interfering in the elections of Bhutan. So we have to be sensitive towards their concerns, and we have to revise India-Bhutan policy and address several issues that are prevailing between India and Bhutan. For instance, hydropower projects that are to be constructed and commissioned by Indian companies are getting delayed. This is a cause of concern for Bhutan. India is moving towards power surplus status. That means India hereafter may not be requiring more power from Bhutan, and the advent of other renewable energies will really make it difficult for Bhutan to ensure that its hydropower sector becomes profitable. So India must find ways to help Bhutan in such a way that it is not accused of same sort of debt trapping that is China is facing. That is, wherever China is investing, the country which is getting the investment are being trapped into debt. Especially African countries, wherever the China is investing, those countries are facing this debt trapping. Similarly, India should not be accused of this problem. Today's fourth topic is half of the farm households are indebted according to NABARD study. More than half of the agricultural households in the country are facing debt problem according to the survey conducted by NABARD. NABARD found that 52.5% of agricultural households had an outstanding loan on the date of survey. For non-agricultural households, the debt percentage is only 42.8%. That means that those who involved in agricultural sector are facing more debt burden than compared to people who are involving in other sector. See the data here. The average debt of indebted agricultural households stood at around 1,04,000, whereas non-agricultural households are facing around 76,731 only. The survey reveals one grim fact, one worrisome fact is that around only 10.5% of agricultural households are found to have valid Kisan credit card at the time of survey. This particular Kisan credit card is very useful because it aims to give farmers a credit from the banks with a simplified and flexible single window procedure. That means that if you have a Kisan credit card with simple procedures, you can get loan. Without Kisan credit card, it is very difficult to get loan from banks. So ultimately, you end up in getting loan from money lenders with paying higher interest rate and debt trapping will be there and people will be suffer from poverty and hunger. Households who had the card utilized around 66% of the credit limit. Why agricultural households are taking loan? 1/4 of the purpose is for capital expenditure alone. If they take 1 lakh loan, around 25,000 they spend for capital expenditure alone. While all classes of farmers had debt, but the highest incidence of indebtedness came from those owning the land for more than 2 hectares. Almost 40% of loan were taken from non-institutional sources such as relatives, friends, moneylenders, landlords. This is a problem. Government wants to ensure that farmers get a farmer loan, that is, they get loan from banks with less interest. They have to get loan with a simplified procedure so that they are not trapped into debt burden. Today's last topic is India building a new fighter jet. You just need to know some factual information, nothing much to understand. The advanced medium combat aircraft, that is India's next indigenous fighter, is expected to make its first flight by 2032. Development for this purpose is underway. The advanced medium combat aircraft will feature geometric stealth, will definitely fly with two GE-414 engines. There are two major ways of making a military platform stealthier. One is geometric stealth and other is material stealth. Initially, geometric stealth will be functioning. Later, material stealth. In geometric stealth, the shape of the aircraft is designed at such angles so as to deflect away maximum radar waves, thereby minimizing its radar cross section. In material stealth, radar absorbing materials are used to make the aircraft, which will absorb the radio waves, thus reducing the radar footprint. This is India's only 5th generation aircraft program following the decision not to go ahead with the 5th generation project with Russia. We have cancelled the project with Russia, so we are going on our own. Thank you.